So, you saw his brother speak earlier about pooping and almost dying. you can just say poop in front of people.
Yeah, poop.
And you say poop and people laugh. So I met Nate, like I said, 18 years ago. You have to press that on mute button. And shortly thereafter, when I came over after a serious bout of sledding one day, I met his little brother Eli. And that's this guy over here. So Eli was in fifth grade when I met him. And their little sister, Hannah, was in second grade when I met him. And I've had the good fortune of having these three dukes in my life for quite a while now. And Eli is...
Check.
I think the most interesting resume I've ever seen. He has a series of entry-level jobs with the greatest range I've ever seen on a resume. So he's got a lot of breadth, but not a lot of depth. The past 4 years, he's gone to Antarctica for a few minutes, and I'm just going to share some stories about that.
Hey, everybody. Can you hear me?
Nope.
Is my mic, am I checked up? All right. So yeah, Shane and I go way back to Indiana, and we certainly have a connection in programming. We started in the PHP world and dove into Ruby together. Got neck deep in the depot. It was good. And then I lived in Indiana most of my life, and then moved to Seattle and went and stayed with my aunt and uncle who live out there, and I just happened to time it perfectly so that a friend of the family's was coming over for a dinner party and a photo slideshow because he had just come back from Antarctica. And it was like unbelievable to me. I didn't even think that such a thing was possible. You know, I mean, it's like you sort of have an idea that some people go there for research and stuff like that, but you don't really know the breadth of it. And so he came, did a little slideshow, and I became sort of infatuated with it, and it took about a year or so for me to actually land a job there, and then I've been going back every summer there, winter here for the past 4 years, and so I'm just going to sort of kind of give an overview of the process. It kind of works out to my advantage here because a lot of times in my life now, sort of going through my non-Antarctica time, the question always comes up, what do you do? And it's sort of a strange thing for me to answer that question because it always becomes a really big story because it's like, they're like, oh, I'm a programmer. It's like, oh, cool, you know, that's nice, you know, but it's like, oh, I work in Antarctica. And then people, it's like, are there roads there? Are there cars there? Do people live underground? You know, it's like it's like, there's no real concept. Until recently, a documentary came out that sort of some people have seen, and I forget what it's called right now,
but
Close Encounters at the End of the World. So that was Werner Herzog, and he filmed that movie the year before I went down there. So I know some of the people that were in that movie, but I myself wasn't in it. But so I've been four times now. I was a dishwasher my first season. I was a plumber assistant. I was an electrical helper. And this last year, I was a fuels operator. So I'm going to kind of like meld everything into one. And it works out because I can tell all of you the same story at once instead of having to repeat myself a bunch of times. Because that inevitably happens with a group of people and someone's like, oh, you work in Antarctica? Wow. Are there roads there? Are there cars? Do people live underground? And then like 5 minutes later, someone else comes over and they start hearing, they're like, well, you live in Antarctica? Wow, that's crazy. Are there roads there? Are there cars there? Do people live underground? And it's just like the same thing over and over again. So one of the first things that people ask is, how do you get that job? And it's a really boring answer that you just apply online. You just put your resume on the internet and hopefully they like you, you know? And if they say you got a job, instead of like going downtown, you go to Antarctica. So it's, everything happens to the National Science Foundation and the United States Antarctic Program. And there's three bases. Primarily, there's McMurdo Station, which is near New Zealand, South Pole, and Palmer Station, which is at south of Chile. which John has to be wearing a shirt right now.
That's right.
The John M. Gould is a boat. Did you know that, John?
Yeah, no, my wife's father goes down there on the research that you're talking about. He got this one.
Nice. So everything happens under the umbrella of the National Science Foundation, the United States Antarctic Program, but they hire, or there's a contract, and currently the contractor is Raytheon, which is an evil, you know, military arms dealer, sort of. But they have one section of their company, which is the Raytheon Polar Services. So you apply online. If they like you, they hire you, and then you go to Denver. And in Denver, it's excruciatingly boring, and you have to sit in chairs kind of like you all right now, listen to someone yammer on for 2 days, like I am right now. And then you all load up in a plane and you fly to Christchurch. And you're there for about 2 days and you sort of hang out in the town, but you also get outfitted with lots of cold weather gear. They give you a coat and a few other things depending on your job. So if they know you're gonna be working outside, you get more cold weather gear than if you're gonna be a dishwasher, for instance. So from there, you load up into a C-17, which is a military cargo plane, and the crew that does those flights is actually out of Tacoma, Washington. And they fly you down to McMurdo, which is the largest station on the continent. In the summertime, there's about 1,000 people there. And it's a small town. It's kind of dirty. Some people describe it as kind of like a mining town. There's probably 100 buildings or so, and there's everything from dishwashers and janitors to doctors and dentists and garbage men and plumbers and just firefighters, everything that is needed for a small town to run, along with all of the research people. And there's sort of a strange divide between the workers and the scientists. And I don't really know why that is, but it's just sort of how it was when I was there. And it's, I think there's just not as much interaction between those two groups because the scientists come in and they do their work and then they go out to the field or something like that. So once you get to McMurdo, it takes a little while to get into it, but the really nice thing is that it's a pretty awesome sort of small community there. There's 1,000 people, so you don't get to know everyone, but you do get to know some people, and you work very closely with a lot of people, and so you become fast friends. You know the people that wash your dishes, you know the people that cook your food, you know the people that run the power plant, you sort of know every little section of that world. And it sort of, for a lot of people, becomes the world, and they keep going back and going back. And as it happened to me, this is my fourth time down. It's possible I'm not going to go back next season, but there's sort of an intention in mind to not get totally stuck into it, because I know people that have been down there going straight every year for 30 years. And seems insane to me. But the community is amazing. Like I said, there's music, there's a band room, and there's lots of live music because people want to fill their time. They want something interesting to do while they're there. And there's the holidays are big celebrations every year. And on New Year's, there's an outdoor music festival called Ice Stop. And it's just a big outdoor party, and it's lots of fun, and the whole community gets into it. And it's sort of like, because there isn't much to do, the things that there are to do, everyone does them. And everyone wants to make them as interesting and as awesome as they can. Let's see here. So my first season, like I said, I was a dishwasher, and that was pretty cool, but not amazing, as you can imagine. It's sort of a common sort of entry-level job, and a lot of people do it their first year, and a lot of people do it just to get there. There's sort of a, what is it? There's sort of a pattern in the dishwasher world that it's like from 18-year-old kids to, you know, 50-year-old men and women, sometimes even older, that just that's a job they can get, and so they go for it. And my first season, there was a woman working down there. She was maybe in her mid-30s, and she had been a lawyer with Arthur Anderson during the Enron scandal. And she was, you know, in the trenches, as Shane was saying. And at one point they said, yeah, you might want to think about just sort of bailing out now while you still can. And so she said, okay. And so she left and went traveling and ended up down there working as a dishwasher. And she was awesome. And there were some younger people working there, some older people, but it's a wide range of people working that job versus my second year when I was a plumber. And that is basically very, for the most part, old, crotchety tradespeople. And it's a really hilarious world for me because I went down there, this was my second season, and I kind of thought, you know, I know what I'm doing now, you know, I can, I've been here before, you know, I understand what's going on. And so I got down there, it was my first day. I woke up in the morning, you know, they have these Carhartt overalls and everything, and I, like, you know, took my first shirt off the pile, and it turned out to be a pink shirt. And that's just sort of a coincidence, because I happen to like that color. But as I walked into the shop on my first day as a plumber, I walked in and I realized that I probably had made a mistake, because to one of my favorite guys that I worked with, his name is Walter, and he was a hilarious, old, he was like 70 years old or so, from Maine. And to him, any one characteristic of me makes me gay. But if you combine all of them into one person and I not be gay, it's an impossibility in his mind. You can see the gears just like grinding in his head, and just like every day he would like learn one more thing. So I walked in my first day, kind of shaggy hair, my ears are pierced, and I'm wearing a pink shirt. And so he started calling me Pinky. And that nickname really took. And as time went along, you know, he'd find out that I was vegetarian. And he was just like, oh my gosh, like, who is this human? You know, how does such a thing exist like this? And the name really stuck, and people kind of ran with it, and it was a good time. But in that world, it was basically this world of kind of older, kind of conservative tradespeople, but it was amazing. They were still wonderful people. He had the best of intentions. I mean, he came by it honestly, in a way. You know, he couldn't help it. And I like to think that maybe I sort of changed his worldview a little bit. I don't know. It's just funny to me that a color can have such an impact on people. Like, I don't think there's a color that a girl can wear that is, like, incompatible with her gender. You know, but like I can wear a pink shirt and it just doesn't match with people. And people sit there like, hey, cool shirt, man. You know. It's like, well, okay. And so I like that. I had a good time. My first season, I was working in the galley, you know, washing dishes for 10 hours a day, 6 days a week, and it kind of gets old. That year, I worked with the plumbers, and it was nice. We got to move around town. We got to go to different buildings. Got to go out to the airfields, and that's sort of the sort of on a base level. That's sort of the farthest that I got out of town, because town is. Maybe a square mile. I'm just kind of guessing right now. It's kind of hard to say how big the town is. And then the airfields are out on the ice shelf, because McMurdo Station is on Ross Island, which is just south of New Zealand. It's not actually on the continent of Antarctica. It's a small island just off the continent. And so it's a big rocky space, and they couldn't build an airfield on the island. And the best place to do it was out on the endless sheet of flat ice that just goes on forever out off the, like, off the island onto the ice shelf. So I would go with Walter frequently out onto the ice shelf. We would take a shuttle because there's a lot of people going out to the airfields back and forth every day. And so we would get on a shuttle, and it's a big 15-passenger van with big, you know, big knobby tires on it, and go out to the airfield and do sort of just general maintenance on the buildings out there and make sure everything is running okay. And so it was a nice sort of change of pace from the season before. I got to work outside, and I got to work with my hands, and I got to build things and stuff like that. And so that was nice. And then my second season, I was an electrical helper. And so sort of the same vibe as the season before, but I was working with electricians instead. And so similar thing, working outside. And then I got to sort of the golden ticket of working in Antarctica is getting off station. That's like people sort of, that's everyone's goal, because it's cool to go to Antarctica and you're washing dishes and stuff like that, but then you start to see the, you see off into the distance and you see the, there's more exciting things off on the horizon. And so from McMurdo, which is, you know, sort of the hub of most scientific activity that occurs on the continent, people, the science groups go from there out into different field camps. They go from there to the South Pole. They go from there to different points of interest of research around the continent. And so I got to go with the electricians to the dry valleys, which is a helicopter ride over to this special area where there's a series of valleys that for some reason don't have any snow in them. It's sort of unknown why that's the case, but it is, and they're being studied. And so I went with the electricians to work on some electrical work there. And so each season has been progressing. Each season has been a little bit more interesting than the last. Each season has been moving along, and so I keep enjoying it. And this last year I worked in fuels. And in the McMurdo word, the fuels operators are fuelies. And we smell like diesel 100% of the time, basically. You spill it on you, it's like you're just around it enough, and so there's a sort of a stigma of fuelies and how we smell, and we sort of sit together at lunch, you know. It's sort of, it feels like you're offending someone, you know. It's like someone sitting down for lunch and then you just, it's like, what was that character in Charlie Brown? Pigpen, yeah. It's like I had stink lines just sort of like coming off of me at all times. And the fuels world was definitely bigger than the worlds before because it was much more responsibility. I wasn't just a helper or an assistant or something like that. I was a fuels operator. And the fuel system at McMurdo is huge and intense and sort of mind-boggling at times. I mean, the basic system is that a fuel tanker comes down every year, offloads 7-8 million gallons of fuel into different bulk tanks, and then that comes out of those tanks and is distributed to buildings to run heaters. It's distributed to the airfields, and to get out to the airfield, which is 13 miles away out on the ice shelf, they have to run, we have to run a 6-inch fuel line 13 miles, and 13 miles of 6-inch fuel line is about 100,000 gallons of fuel if it's just sitting in the line. And so every couple days, we would do transfers out to the fuel, out to the airfields to fuel the planes, primarily so that they could fly to field camps, but also so that they could deliver fuel to the South Pole. Because if the fuel, if the South Pole runs out of fuel, just like McMurdo, but if the South Pole runs out of fuel, then it would be bad. And fortunately, like I said, each season keeps kind of progressing. This season, I got to go to the South Pole to work with the fuel, just as part of the fuels crew, because there's three people that work at the South Pole permanently every year in the fuels department, and there's one rotator from McMurdo every year. And so I worked at the airfield of McMurdo fueling planes that were flying to the South Pole throughout the year, and then at the end of the season I got to go down there and work with them. And so the fuel comes in a tanker, goes into a tank, gets pumped 13 miles out to the airfield, gets pumped into a plane that then flies to the South Pole and then gets pumped out of that plane into tanks that then run the generators. And they fill up a plane with about 8,000 gallons of fuel. They fly to the South Pole, offload about 3,000 gallons, and then fly back. So it takes about a gallon of fuel to get a gallon of fuel to the South Pole. And so it's pretty inefficient in the grand scheme of things. And there's a push over the last 5 or 6 years for, and it's continuing now, for a South Pole Traverse, which is where we fill up giant bladders of fuel and people in tractors drive them to the South Pole. And so they're trying to work more on that. But working at the South Pole was pretty cool. It was cool to see the whole sort of link in the system, the whole sort of process. I was there at the very end at the South Pole working before closing, because you have to get just the right amount of fuel there before they close for the winter, because the South Pole is open for about 3.5 months in the summertime. And during that time, people are coming, going, flights are coming, going, and moving through. And then it starts to get too cold, because the planes can only operate above minus 55 degrees Fahrenheit. And when it gets below that, they don't work anymore. They have failures and they fall apart and the engines shut down. And so they push and push and push to get as much fuel in as they can. And then at a certain point, they just have to stop because it starts getting too cold. So we just barely got in. I think as we were leaving, it was just getting to about 400,000 gallons that they need at the South Pole to run the station for the winter. And that's primarily for the generators and for the larger telescope science projects that happen down there. So we finished. The last offload of fuel was the plane that we flew out on. So I was at the tanks where the fuel gets offloaded to, and I opened the valve so that the fuel would flow in. And then I grabbed my stuff and walked up to the airfield. The plane finished offloading, and then we just got on that plane and flew out. And everyone that was at the South Pole that was staying for the winter, it was about 50 people or so that'll be there for 8 months or so. They all came out to the airfield, and as we were flying away, they kind of like, it's sort of a deal that they, it's like, well, there it goes. That ain't happening again for a while, you know. So, flew back to McMurdo, and then that 13 miles of fuel line that we laid out to the airfield, we had to roll up, because you can't leave it over the winter, it'll get buried, and then you won't be able to find it. So, the very, sort of the second to last flight out of McMurdo flew out. There was a tank that was left there at the airfield that had enough fuel to fuel the last plane that came in, and then it was just the winter population and then the fuels people that were staying to tear down the fuel line. And so we broke into two crews. We worked, like, within the two crews, a little overlap, about 20 hours a day, just rolling up fuel line. And it took 6 days, I think, total, to roll up 13 miles. At the most, we would roll up maybe 2 to 3 miles a day, I think. And once that was done, then the last plane came in before the McMurdo winter, and I got on that last plane and flew out to Christchurch. From there, basically, you are normally just put up in a hotel for a day or two, and then you can go home, you can stay in New Zealand, you can sort of travel from there. But right at the moment when basically the most possible Antarctic-related people can be in Christchurch that is possible was when the earthquake hit. And so there was about 600 United States Antarctic Program people sort of around the Christchurch area when the earthquake hit. And it was kind of a big deal for the people that we were still down in Antarctica, because we didn't know. I mean, buildings were crumbling and collapsing, and it was like we had friends in the city and didn't know what was going on, and somehow not a single Antarctic-related person was injured. And so then when we were on our way out, we were not encouraged to stay in the city at all. We had to, basically they put us up for one night, and then we were heavily encouraged to get on a plane to fly to Auckland to just leave, because they didn't want us getting in the mix of things. But I stayed on the South Island anyway, and sort of just didn't hang out in the earthquake area, but and made my way home. And in the process of being down in Antarctica, Shane had told me about the conference and told me about this going on, and I was hoping it would work into my plans, but it didn't sound like it was. And I'm really glad that it did, because I got to come out here and hang out. And I got here on Monday and helped mow the backyard. It's deceiving right now, but it was a jungle just a few days ago. And do some other things, and it's been fantastic. And so I just want to thank Shane, and I think we should all give him a little round of applause. It certainly takes sort of some, I don't know, what's that like?
Balls.
There we go. you sort of like can't be afraid to fail, I think. That's pretty cool. So thanks for your time. If anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
I have two
Mike.
Questions.
Mike. Sorry, over here.
I have two questions. Although you sort of answered it with McMurdo, but do people at the South Pole all celebrate New Year's at the same time where they are, even though they're from different countries, or do they celebrate with their own country? That's kind of one. And
yeah.
The other is, how the hell do you roll up a 2 mile long, or whatever,
13 miles
a day? Just the geometry of it, like, where does it go? Is there a giant spool?
Okay.
You might get super huge.
So McMurdo and the South Pole are all on New Zealand time. So that's just sort of the general rule.
Because they're all U.S. workers.
Yeah, they're mainly U.S. workers.
What about the South Pole? What time do they celebrate New Year's Day in the South Pole?
Same as New Zealand time. Yeah, because it's sort of like New Zealand is the logistical hub, so it makes sense to be on the same time as that, so they can just orchestrate things. Rolling up the hose, it's in 600-foot sections. Well, there's 600-foot sections, but then there's three 600-foot sections that are considered to be one reel, and there are about 40 reels. So
do you roll it up, drive it back?
Yeah, there's it's that time of the season is there's lots of help from lots of other departments. So there's like the heavy equipment operators. There's like a couple of heavy equipment operators that are assigned to us, and it's like a constant thing of like, this reel is full, take it away, bring another one, you know. And so it's a big operation to get it done in time.
I have two really serious questions. The first one is, do you think it's cold right now? I'm freezing.
It's a little chilly. Yeah, you adapt pretty quickly. It's surprising.
The second one is, did they keep calling you Pinky after that second year? Or?
Yeah, there's some people that only knew me as that. They're like, just never learned my name, you know? It was really one of the first times I ever had a nickname. Like a real nickname that, you know, there's some people that I know that I, even now, I've known them for years and I don't know their name. Like I don't know what their actual name is. I just know their nickname. So some people stuck with it. Some people still do.
So I was wondering this the entire time. Does anyone live underground?
Are there roads? Do they drive cars?
There are roads and there are cars, yeah. But people don't live underground.
You mentioned that you guys have outdoor concerts sometimes.
Yeah.
How cold is it when you have your outdoor concerts?
The warmest time of the year is right at New Year's.
I guess that's my question.
Yeah. The warmest time of the year is right at New Year's, because that's sort of like the middle of the summer. And so it is not uncommon for it to be like 40 degrees. And when the sun is shining and you've been accustomed to 20 below, it's like 40 degrees is It's lovely. It's glorious. And the sun is shining. You could be outside in a t-shirt. You'd feel comfortable. You'd be okay with that.
Is there anything you have to do about, like, visas or anything? Probably.
Well, that's fortunately taken care of through the company that we work for. They get a special, like, letter that's, like, to the New Zealand custom or visa people, or when you go through customs, that gets us a 9-month visitor visa in New Zealand, because technically while we're in Antarctica, we're in New Zealand, because when you go to Antarctica, you're not going to another country.
You're in the last country.
The last country you were in was New Zealand, so that's where you were the whole time, technically. And so you get a 9-month visa, which works out because the longest stint is usually about like August to February, which is 6 months. And so when you leave, you still have 3 months left on your visa. So if you wanted to, you could, without doing anything, you could stay in New Zealand for another 3 months if you wanted to.
John wants to know about background checks, and you should also talk about PQ.
About what?
PQ.
Oh, okay. So background checks, yes, there are some. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, they go through, like, HireRight. It's some company that makes phone calls and pokes around. And, yes, there's a pretty involved, like, medical checkup process that once you get hired, you have to go through the you have to have a physical, you have to get blood work done, you have to have a dental checkup. So it's involved, and some people get really close to going, and then right at the last minute something happens, and they fail their, like, medical says, you're not good enough, you're not healthy enough, or something like that, so.
So, in Antarctica, during our winter, your summer.
Yep.
Is it pretty much daylight the whole time?
Yeah, it is. Yep.
Daylight
is less of an issue than you'd think, because it's really easy to make darkness. You can just cover your windows and start, you know, and you can go sleep. I've never done a winter, so winter would be very difficult, because then you can't really synthesize daylight and sunshine. So people that winter say that that's much more difficult, but a constant daylight is actually nice, because you can always do stuff outside. It's like, if it's late and you feel like going on a hike, doesn't matter, because the sun is shining.
I remember a few years ago there was a rescue mission for someone that needed emergency surgery. Was that on the winter crew? And
yeah, I think I've heard that was the winter crew at the winter South Pole. And I think the story I remember was that it was a woman who found out she had, like, advanced some stage of breast cancer, and she was actually the doc, and she had to give herself surgery. So she had attendants, like, they trained and they sent down, like, you know, they like through the internet, like special things for the attend for other people.
So, the video?
Yeah, so they like trained, they like, yeah, she did most of the work, but there were people there that, like, had some understanding. Yeah.
Who did they get to play Ice Stock?
Those are all local bands. It's just bands that have formed during the season. I was in sort of a blues, funk, rock sort of cover band this year. And we did for iStock, the lead singer, who is, like, really obsessed with, you know, having a really awesome like stage performance, he gets really into it, and so he made the paper mache heads for us to be the Muppet band this year. So I got to be Animal, which was pretty cool. And it's all just it's pretty much anyone who wants to do anything. It's really kind of a cool moment for people to just throw bands together and do there was a group that kind of opened up. They were the Ukuleles, these two girls that played ukulele and sang, and you know, so just whatever anybody can throw together, it's pretty awesome.
I don't know if this makes any sense or not, but I've heard that there's a club in Antarctica where you get a badge for running streaking into a sauna. There's like an official run that you do.
It's possible. It's at the South Pole in the winter. I've never done it, but it's called the 300 Club.
Yeah.
Where the sauna is 200 degrees. And the outside temperature, the ambient outside temperature is minus 100. So it's like a 300 degree temperature difference. And so they crank up the sauna.
I'm already dying to stare at them.
Yeah, they crank up the sauna, and then you're in the sauna, and then you run outside, and you have to run around the pole, I think. You have to run outside and run around the pole and then run back inside.
That's exactly what it was.
This question is probably kind of lame, but...
Sorry.
Yeah.
What do they do about, like, waste? Like, garbage and stuff?
That's a good one.
And poop, yes.
And poop. Okay, well,
I know all about that.
What's that?
I know all about
yeah,
that.
Yeah, Nate, my brother Nate over here was down there. We went down together our first season, and he worked at the wastewater treatment plant.
Disgusting.
Yeah. So it used to be, in the not-so-distant past, that waste was just flushed into the ocean. And the immediate ocean surrounding McMurdo is a filthy, filthy place. But you know, in recent times they put in a wastewater treatment plant, and so that pulls out the waste and whatever. All the other waste is, including the solid human waste, is like contained in these sort of tri-wall kind of pallet boxes. There's food waste. It's like when you're there, like here, you know, there's like, oh, there's recyclables and there's trash and there's compostables. There's like 10 different divisions of your trash, and it's a big point of like community sort of like, you got to sort your trash, you have to heavily sort your trash, and it all gets divided up, and then there's a resupply vessel that comes down every year and brings in new supplies, you know, dried food, frozen food, you know, anything you can think of, and then it leaves full of trash. So it comes down, offloads a bunch of stuff, and then they unload a whole year's worth of trash, and then they take it away.
I have a couple of footnotes to the... I've heard the Antarctica stories for a few years, so... and it's too bad Mickey had to leave early, because they have a sort of recycle program there called skua. Skuas are the little birds in Antarctica, and basically, like, I'm done with these shoes, you can't really throw them away or, like, take them to Goodwill, so there's a room full of... stuff you don't want, people take it. That's a pretty cool little program they got going on there.
Mm-hmm.
And I've heard a lot of these stories, and it wasn't until Eli started putting all his photos on Flickr that it really started to make sense. And we were talking about it the other day, and Books and I think that Eli has the most published photos of Antarctica. it paints a picture, you know, fuller than what he can say. His Flickr handle is Eli's Fan Club, and what else? Everyone that I've met as a part of the like Antarctica circles is just great, well-rounded, you know, like fun, you know, like nice people. That's the last thing we have from Eli. So thanks, Eli.
Yep.